That's it.
No worries. Well, it's a pleasure to be in Fayetteville today, and for a number of reasons. One of these reasons is that it's the name of a city in the United States that I can pronounce with my French mouth, because it looks like a French word. And actually, if it looks like a French word, it is because it's a French word. If you have been to Paris, you are probably my shop in the Galerie Lafayette, one of the most fashionable store in Paris, but there is no relationship between the Galerie Lafayette and Fayetteville. The link is through this little village here in the center of France, not far from where I was born, actually, about 200 miles. It is called Chavagnac-Lafayette. And if you go there, you will see that you are welcome in English, welcome to Lafayette's native village, because actually this guy was born there. You know the name, Marie-Joseph, Pauli, Gilbert Dumotier de Lafayette, at that time, you know. He was just known as Marquis et Général de Lafayette, and he took part in the American War of Independence for 4 years. He befriended Washington, Hamilton, Jefferson. His son was called George Washington de Lafayette. And then he played a big role in the French Revolution and following the tumultuous years. And he was an aristocrat who sided with the people. So he's well known in France. He took part in writing the Declaration of Human Rights too. So he's well known in France for his, the role he played in the American War of Independence. So this is why, if you go to Savagnac Lafayette, a chance, you will see that in front of the castle where he was born, there is two flags, one from France and the other one, United States. And this is why in North America or in the United States, there is a lot of places called Fayette or Lafayette or various variation on the same team, but this is to honor this guy. I was a little bit disappointed in terms of pronunciation, because in France we say Lafayette with a very strong Y. And so I would assume that Fayetteville is pronounced Lafayette, but it's just Fayetteville, so you skip the Y. I will forgive for that, because it's your language, it's a city, you do what you want. And you forgive me for my poor English and pronunciation. So about the hydration, there is two different aspects in hydration. The hydration state and the hydration process. The hydration state is simply the volume of water in the body, which varies between subjects, of course, but is well defended and pretty stable in a given subject. It's stable and could vary between 35 and 70% of body mass. And if it is well defended, it is because there is an hydration process, which is dynamic process, more interesting. And this process defends the total body water by controlling the water flux in the total body water pool and controlling what we call the water turnover, which is the amount of water coming into the body water pool every day, for example, and coming out from this pool, and by and large, these values are the same. The same amount of water is coming into the body water pool and coming out from the body water pool. So, a few words on the state of hydration. The total body water varies from one subject to the other because present body water, the ratio between total body water and body mass, depends on percent body fat. This is due to the fact that, as written in this review paper, the observed ratio of total body water to fat-free body mass is stable at, and there, don't understand what, there is some strange sign here, but it's 0.73%. So it does everybody, by and large, at 73% of the lean body mass is water. So depending on the amount of body fat, the percent body water in the body will vary and will be of course, larger in the thin person than in the fat person, and the extreme are something like that in the person with a very, very low body fat, like the bodybuilders. They could have like something like 70% body water, and very fat people, morbid obesity, people with morbid obesity and maybe 55% body fat, have only 35% body weight as water. And the textbook male subject with 60% body weight is somebody with 17.8% body fat, which is pretty lean. So you will see these people in about there, and there is a large percentage of population with less than 60% body fat. This percentage of body water is pretty constant, and if you increase the amount of fluid ingested, it will not change much. This is shown in this study performed in elderly subjects. They have been instructed for 6 months to increase their fluid intake by 1.5 liter a day, and they did, because this is the amount of water, this is actually the water turnover, the total water turnover per day before the experiment and after 6 months of experiment. There is an increase by 1 liter versus an instruction to increase by 1.5 liter. But if you look at the total body water pool, it remains at 42 liters. So you can increase your water intake, you will not increase your total body water. This could be also shown in this study by a couple of people you know, who are in this room, and one that in this room that you know also. This is a novel hydration assessment technique employing a water intake challenge. So the water intake challenge is just to ask people to drink quite fast a large amount of water. In this situation, they receive a little bit more than 800 milliliters in 3 minutes, which is a good amount of water. And you hydrated subject, well, they pee almost all the fluid they receive. And in the subject acutely, moderately dehydrated, they keep this amount of water because they need it. So if you need the water, you keep it. If you don't, you just pee it. By the way, I like this water intake challenge. I think it could be developed in an interesting test, but you have already experienced that, because if you indulge in that type of activity, and if you ingest maybe slightly more fluid that you need, you will have to visit these facilities. So the regular. So a stable total body water, and this is in spite of a large difference in the total amount of water which enter the pool and come out of the pool every day. This is shown in this very nice study performed of a large number of American adults. And you see here the distribution of the ingestion of water in liter per day. So it's not the turnover, but the good part, the turnover. And you can see that people are ingesting not much water. Some people are ingesting a lot of water, in average you are here, but the total body fluid remains stable. Another experience, or it's a case study, a subject taking part into the race across America from the west to the east coast in bike for about 11 days, and you see here the water intake, which averaged 6 liters per day. So you can see the amount. In fact, he was encouraged to drink a lot. The first day he was very eager. He drank 28 liters of water. In fact, he was overhydrated, because if you look at the urine production, it's 6 liters per day, which shows that the kidney did a very good job. You give water because you think that this guy will need a lot of water because he has excess in the heat, but you give much too much. He may just get rid of the water. Again, you defend well your total body water. So one way to look at the hydration process, there are others, but one way, it's using tracer technique with deuterium oxide, D2O. What is deuterium oxide? Here you have a normal water, oxygen and two hydrogen, and this is normal water or light water. The molar mass is 18 gram. And if you replace the hydrogen by deuterium, which is an isotope, stable isotope of hydrogen, but with a higher molar mass, you obtain deuterium oxide, which is heavy water with a molar mass of 20 gram per mole. You cannot by just weighing two bottles of water know which is which, but if you make ice cube from this normal water or the deuterium oxide water and you put that in the glass of normal water, this deuterium oxide will go at the bottom and the other ice attract. It seems nice. The other ice stay on the top. It's totally safe to use because it's a stable isotope of hydrogen, so it's not radioactive like tritium. It's there for a long time and it will stay there for a long time. It doesn't produce any radioactivity. Up to 100 grams have been used without any problem in man. It is toxic in rodent when you replace 20% of or half of the body water by the deuterium oxide. But we never achieved that in man, of course, much too costly. We use actually very small dose. The natural abundance of deuterium oxide is that, which is about 150 ppm. And in an 80 kilogram subject with 60% of water, there is about 8 grams of deuterium oxide in the body. So you all have between, I would say, 6 and 10 grams of deuterium oxide. And for pressure technique, we use about 6 to 10 grams. It's not expensive, and it can be very accurately measured by mass spectrometry, by the ratio deuterium over H. It's not cheap. This is the expensive part of the study, but it can be afforded. And it's a technique with a very, very great accuracy. The mass spectrometry, very simply, because I'm not an expert in that, you just ionize what you want to analyze, and you send that into between two electrodes, and on the path, you put a very strong and stable magnet, which will deviate the particle according to their mass. The heavier the particle, the more difficult it is to deviate, and the lighter, the easier. So if you make a mixture of normal hydrogen, deuterium, and tritium, you will recover the normal hydrogen here. Here you will recover the deuterium and here tritium. And again, the accuracy of this technique is very, and it's easy to understand because you have three particles with a mass of 1, 2, and 3. So it's easy for the mass spectrometer to distinguish them. So what we can do with that? We can look at the absorption of water, the distribution of the water in the body water pool, and the volume of the total body water pool, and the disappearance of water from this pool. So this is what we did in this experiment, published in 2012. Pharmacokinetic analysis of absorption, distribution of disappearance of ingested water labeled with deuterium oxide in humans. So the first part of this study, which was conducted by 36 male subjects, you get the characteristic here, in a fasting state at 8 o'clock, they receive 300 milliliters of tap water with deuterium oxide to study the absorption of water. So, on the following minute, over 1 hour, we collected blood sample to look at the appearance of deuterated water in the blood. And this is what we observed. These are the individual beta and the mean and the standard deviation. So there is a baseline value, the formal enrichment, the baseline enrichment in deuterium in Montreal, because this was the problem first, is about 150, and we obtained 149, which is not too bad. By the way, it's a little bit more enriched in 5B, it's 152, for some interesting reason. We can see that there is a very rapid absorption of water because 5 minutes after ingestion, there's an increase in the pH ratio in the blood, and it plateaus between, I would say, 20 and 30 minutes, and after that, level off. The half time for the absorption was about 10 minutes, which means that in about a little bit more than 1 hour, all was probably absorbed and distributed in the total body water pool. Is it possible to absorb this amount of water, 300 milliliters, in this amount of time? The answer is yes, because the capacity to absorb water is quite high. It has been measured in various ways. The more direct way is just to ask people to drink water at various rates, up to 6 liters per hour. So you will imagine the guy in the bed and drinking water. And at some point you will develop diarrhea. You look the amount of water which has been kept by the gut. And when this experiment is performed, this is an old experiment, but I think it's simple enough that the data will be very good. It tends to get the absorption rate tend to plateau around 15 milliliters per minute. So in 30 minutes, you have already absorbed 450 milliliters, and in 1 hour, it is the figure which is reported everywhere, milliliters per hour. A surprising or interesting finding, not really surprising, interesting finding is that in some subjects, the absorption was followed a smooth increase toward the plateau. In other subjects, there is a quick right increase in the DH ratio, and then the value get back to the same plateau value as the other subject. This suggests that there was a difference between these two groups in the distribution of the ingested water in the water space, and it has been already reported in this study by Hill in 2004 that you can observe this peak followed by a slow decrease toward the plateau. So in our experiment, we analyze using a pharmacokinetic model the absorption in these two groups of subjects. In the first group of subjects, the model is very simple. There is just one compartment in which the ingested water has a total access quickly, so you get a smooth increase in the concentration of the DH. In the other subject, there is two compartments, one with a very quick access, and it includes the blood, so you see a large increase in the concentration of deuterium in the blood. And then there is another compartment for which the access is a little bit slower, so there is a delay between ingestion and the appearance of the water in this other compartment, which gives this appearance of DH in the blood. Of course, it's impossible in man, except if we can cut it in pieces, to know where are these compartments, but in animals, very old studies, 1950, by the same team, in animal, studied this the distribution of water ingested or administered in the blood, and you can see that if you put the time on the log scale, and if you look at the appearance of the water in this compartment, you see that the appearance is quite fast in the liver and in the cerebral cortex, which are well-perfused tissue, but for the muscle, at rest, not perfused enough, but not a lot, It takes a longer time to reach the plateau. The bones are further, I perfuse less, and the deuterium oxide is appeared after a longer period. And there is finally this compartment, which are the transudates. So it's ascites, for example. This was performed in a patient with ascites or pleural expansion, called that. Edema. So in this compartment, which is called the transcellular fluid, the appearance of water is much longer, and it can take up to 6 hours to reach this compartment. But these are sick. So absorption, distribution, we can also look at the volume and the disappearance. The subjects were followed for 9 days, and they were instructed to drink, in addition to their normal diet, 2 liters per day of mineral water. And they provide urine sample every other day for 9 days, and we measure DH in urine, and we observe a curvilinear decrease in the concentration beginning at the day after the ingestion up to the end of the observation period, at a time when there was still a lot of deuterium in the body, since the basal value, I remember, is 150 ppm, and the subject were about 200 ppm. So there is a slow exponential decrease in the DH, which follows the turnover of the total body water pool, and we can use this curve, an analysis of this curve, to follow the turnover of the body water pool. It's impossible to explain in details the computation, although they are not really complicated. But the water disappearance follows an exponential decay, so you linearize the data by transforming the DH in log of DH, then you have a straight line, and you can compute the total body volume by back extrapolating the line to the time of ingestion, which is kind of technique when you do dilution experiment. So you can measure the total body water volume. Then from this equation, you can also compute the half-life of water in the body, which is the time needed to replace 50% of the total body water pool, which is just related to the slope of the regression and the logarithm of 2. You can also compute the mean residence time of ingested water, MRT, the average time the water you are ingested now will stay in your body. And you can compute the daily water flux, which is the total amount of fluid total body, your body water, or coming out from the body water every day. The computation, again, it's not complicated. You can do that on just a very small Excel file. So this is what we observe in the subject. We observe that this subject has a total body water of 46.6 liters, which represent a little bit more than 60% body mass, and 72% lean body mass, which is close to the standard value of 0.73. I get an animation here. Wow. So this guy were followed for a couple of days, and you see there the half-life of the total body water pool, the time needed to replace half of the body water pool. During this about 7.17 days, roughly a week, about half of the body water pool disappeared and has been replaced by new water. And if you continue that, after about 50 days, you have replaced all the water which was present at day zero by new water, because at that time there is only maybe 0.001% of the water present at time zero remaining in the body. So if we compare this data with some data which available to about the turnover of water in various populations. First, there are not many data on that. The only good data is this study by Raman in 458 North American, and this study was performed on male and female, various age group. This is the total turnover, liter per day. This is the half-life. This is the mean residence time. And this is the percentage of the total body water which is replaced each day. Easy to compute. You can see that by and large, whatever the sex and the age, the subject, the flux of water range between 2.8 and 3.8. There is a difference between male and female because the male drink and eat a little bit more than the female, but it doesn't change much with age. And by and large, within 7 days, 1 week, the subject have replaced half of their body water. The mean residence time is about 10 days, and every day, about 10% of the total body water is replaced. And this is the general population in North America, so, and 458 subjects, so large sample. In our study, we observe a larger flux of water, but don't forget that the instruction to the subject was drink 2 liters per day, in addition to the regular diet. I suspect that the normal diet contained 3.5 liters of water. They should have increased that to 5.5, but it's not possible. In all of the study, when people instructed to increase the body water intake in the group, a little bit less. So we observed the 4.5 liter per day, which indicated that they drink probably half of the amount requested. The half-life is also about 1 week, MRT about 10 days, and 10% of the total body fluid is replaced every day. There is a study in Europe, in France actually, and you see 3.5 liter per day, excuse me, with a half-life of 8.5, because the subjects were younger and with larger total body water, but quite similar value. The three last study I took as a sample are on very young subject, 1.5 year old subject, so young, very young children, male and female. The total flux of water is a little bit above 1 liter, but they have a very small size of the body water pool. So the half-life is very small, and the MRT is small, and they replace 16% of their fluid every day. And this is why this type of subject are very susceptible to a lack of hydration, because they are losing a lot of their body water every day. In this study by Stoffen, I don't know the age of the subject, but these were football players from Oklahoma and training in a uniform in the heat, and you can see the amount of the flux of water, 10 liters per day, which is three times the normal value, with a very short half-life and the renewal of the body water pool, which is larger. And you get this case study, the guy crossing America from the west to the east coast, drinking 16 liters of water a day. The half-life is very short, of course, and he's replacing almost 30% of his body water every day. But again, this is a good study on a lot of subjects. These are almost anecdotal evidence. We need more data. So what? You listen to that and you say, I'm sure you are thinking so. The first way to answer to that question is to look at the comment we have when we published this study in 2011, actually, it went online, in the blog Sweat Science that you maybe know, and now it's under Reynolds World. It was well reviewed, well reported, well analyzed, with the same figure we have in the publication. And the conclusion of the blogger was that, so what does this all mean? I don't have any particular application in mind. I just thought it was kind of cool. So science is cool first. But if you are more practically oriented, there are some data coming out now suggesting that the flux of water in the body has some importance in terms of health. Not so much the total amount of water in the body, because this is well defined. But the problem is, are you defending that with a large flux and you help your kidney, or you are defending that with a small flux and your kidney has to work to sustain your total body water? So I will not go into the detail, but you are, Professor Clark recently has shown presented the first large RCT conduct on the effect of increased water intake on the kidney health. And so there is an interest in this field. And this is why you get this type of campaign, drink water, and there is no evidence for any harm. So you can go, and I encourage to do so. But the relationship between water and health will be probably difficult to show. First, because it's probably weak. I don't expect finding any segment of population where the variation in fluid intake will explain 90% of the difference in morbidity and mortality. No, it's certainly a factor, but not strong. And in order to measure a factor which doesn't have a very strong effect, you need very good tools. And the hydration process, there is not that many tools that we have at the present time. It is not well known, not well appreciated, this importance of the flux, and difficult to measure. So I think that the tracer technique with D2O is one of the techniques, not nearly the only one, but one of the techniques which can be used to study this phenomenon. So this is my conclusion. I'll leave you with this picture of Ottawa in winter time, where there is a very long rink, 5 miles, where when it's cold and beautiful, everybody skates. Thank you. Exercise per se does not increase this turnover. What it does, it will increase the loss because of the sweating. Yeah. And this will trigger thirst, and in the following days, quite quickly, you will compensate. So this is the way by which exercise increases the flux. For example, in this football player, they exercise in the heat, they sweat a lot, they have to drink a lot, and they will probably be encouraged to drink. But even if you are not encouraged, you will drink, and within about say, 18 hours, 24 hours, even if you have good, strong dehydration, will have recovered, but you have ingested more water, so the flux is higher. It's simple way by which exercise exhaust increases the indirect flux.
Hi, I'm JD Adams. I'm working on my PhD in exercise science here at the University of Arkansas. Exercise science, simply put, is understanding how to maximize the body's health and performance. I'm interested in the science of heat and hydration in both healthy people and people with medical conditions. Let me show you what students and faculty are studying in the Hume Performance Laboratory at the U of A. Concussions are a serious concern for athletes of all ages. Dr. R.J. Elbin studies the neurocognitive, physical, and psychosocial effects of sport-related concussion in youth and college-age athletes. His research focuses on identifying factors that influence concussion risk and recovery. Whoa! Dr. Michelle Gray does research on functional fitness to help older adults live independently as long as possible. She studies muscular power, an aspect of fitness that gets to the heart of the matter. Maintaining adequate muscular power helps prevent fall injuries, the leading cause of both fatal and non-fatal injuries among older adults. Well, how'd I do?
JD, I've got good news and bad news. The good news is you survived the test. The bad news is the worst reading we've ever seen.
Man, I need to work on my core strength. Dr. Barry Brown created this device called the AB test to quantify core strength. His research has shown that sit-ups measure abdominal muscle endurance, not strength. Building the core reduces lower back pain and enhances athletic performance. Wow, there's some fascinating stuff in here. Diabetes begins with insulin resistance in the skeletal muscle. Dr. Nicholas Green is researching how we can use exercise to combat those effects. His research is working toward ways we can prevent diabetes and related diseases or lessen their severity. Dr. Tyrone Washington's research focuses on how different physiological conditions, such as obesity and aging, affect muscles' ability to recover from damage. Nothing like water to quench your thirst, but too little water can have a big impact on a person's health, exercise performance, and cognitive function. By artificially inducing thirst and monitoring the body's response, Dr. Stavros Kavaras shows that even small degrees of dehydration can also affect kidney function, glucose metabolism, and hormonal changes. Man, this suit is hot, but researchers use it to study body temperature control. Dr. Matthew Ganio's research focus is on understanding how hydration and heat stress affect people with medical conditions such as diabetes and obesity. The findings from this research have implications for how to improve long-term cardiovascular health. Man, it's hot in there. But Dr. Brenda McDermott needs a heat chamber like this to do research on prevention and treatment of exertional heat stroke and hydration status in athletes. His studies can have profound benefits not only for athletes, but also people such as soldiers and those who work in extreme weather conditions. Well, what do you think? Pretty cool stuff, huh? Many of our graduates go on to work in clinical, sport, and academic settings. If any of this interests you, visit our website. You can be a part of the important research going on to help people live healthier lives. We look forward to hearing from you.